We'll do it live. Do it live. I'll write it and we'll do it live. Thing sucks.
You see, KYJ, things have changed just a little bit since the last time you were here.
I think you should see your oculus. Nothing wrong with my feet. I'm talking about your eyes.
I can even make my ass do tricks. Watch this.
You have any idea where you are? You're in the jungle, baby. This is WCW. That's right. Hold on.
For over 10 years, the world's number one source for professional wrestling news and information. And once again, here's your hosts, Damian Nelson, Frank Cosentino, and the man they call Meathead. This is the Pro Wrestling Report on 540 ESPN.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Pro Wrestling Report on 540 ESPN and ESPNMilwaukee.com. Along with Dave Hero. Rashi Brown, the man they call Meathead.
Rashi Brown is not the man they call Meathead, Frank. It's not morning, it's
moron.
Night.
And the man they call Meathead.
Boy, you're
Thank
all getting
you.
Hot pretty soon, aren't you?
Well, I'm being trampled on.
Damian Nelson's on remote somewhere in the United States.
Oh, come on. Let's tell the world where he is in case they see him down there.
If you do see him on...
He's the one riding the float.
He's on Bourbon Street.
He's on Bourbon Street.
Drinking bourbon. No, nah, probably not.
Hurricanes, tequila, Jägermeister.
Rusty nails.
All of the above. His favorite drink, a lot.
You know, guys like Damian only have 2 drinks a night. You realize that, right? The first and the last.
That's right.
What happens between is nobody's business.
We'd like you to join the program, 800-990-ESPN, 414-276-ESPN, locally in Milwaukee. A jam-packed show.
It's ridiculous.
It's crazy. Let's go through, set the table here for you. TNA against all odds. We're going to talk about the pay-per-view from last night. TNA to move to Monday night. That was the big news. We want to get your thoughts on that. The Elimination Chamber is next week in WWE. You just watched Raw along with us.
Sheamus.
Some strange things happening on Raw. We'll talk about that with Jerry Springer hosting. Later on in the program, if you live in the Milwaukee area, or at least southeastern Wisconsin, we've got 2 giveaways for you. SmackDown.
Nah.
Coming to town. We have tickets to give away to that. You got to live in southeastern Wisconsin, though. And then, if you also live in the area, Romine's has a giveaway, the best seat in the house for their pay-per-view coming up. So it's all coming up in this jam-packed 2 hours. And then finally, second hour, Al Snow.
Special guest host.
The program, get his thoughts on professional wrestling, what's going on in his world, and all you have to do is introduce Al,
and Al will be taking everyone's calls, too.
That's right. If you got a question for him, the second hour he will be joining us. But, gentlemen,
as
yes,
long
sir.
As Al's got to know that we have to take commercial breaks. He cannot have all 60 minutes.
That's true. But it is a jam-packed show. Let's get started with what happened last night. TNA, against all odds, it was basically one of their first pay-per-views where they had time to put something together. It wasn't just kind of thrown into pieces, basically. Here was something where, here we go, guys, the first of the regime
and also
change
the biggest story of the night last night as well.
Do you want to give Dave just his time right now to clear it up,
hey,
Frank?
I was right. The Nasty Boys are here to stay. The
correct.
Nasty Boys and Jimmy
Why?
Hart beat Team 3D.
No, that's not the biggest story. The story that's blowing up the chatmosphere right now, the story that's blowing up
okay.
the YouTube
let,
page,
let
the
me
story
address
that's blowing
it right
up
now.
Twitter, the story that's blowing up Facebook,
Wait,
Dave let, Hero.
Of course, of
Do you
course.
Want to set the table?
Before
all
we
with
get into
Meathead,
it.
You know, being the, what do you call it, the director of all this nonsense.
Before we get into it, PWRshow.com, I forgot
correct.
To mention, the chatmosphere is all set up.
Yep.
You'll be monitoring that. And, okay, against all odds.
All right.
It's been
let,
talked
let
about
me
all
get out
set
of the way.
Story. Set the
Last
for
week
it.
On primetime.
At PWRshow.com.
PWRshow.com. I said that the Pope would never headline a TNA pay-per-view.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, let's just get a couple things straight. First of all, yes, he did win the 8-card stud tournament. Congratulations. Very well done. But just because he was in the last match of the show last night, does not mean he was the headliner in the main event. The headlining match was AJ Styles versus Samoa Joe. Now, with that being said, Since he won the tournament, he is now the number one contender to AJ Styles' TNA World title, and will be getting a title match at Lockdown. Now, that could very well be the main event. Or they could have another match that will be ranked higher than that on the card. So as of right now, as of today, until they announce the Lockdown pay-per-view card, he still is not headlining anything.
Because, I'm waiting for you to finish.
Okay.
Just try not to step on
you. And here's the thing. And for those of you that are going to boo me and whatever else, keep in mind, a couple, what, four, five, six Royal Rumbles ago, who did Brock Lesnar face? Bob Holly. Right?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. Was that the main event of the Rumble? No.
That was when they had two different titles.
Hold on. But the headlining match was the Royal Rumble. So now let's say the headlining
really
match.
Splitting hairs.
No. Okay, hold
finish.
On. Frank, call
hey,
it. Hold
like
on.
It
no. If TNA promotes Lockdown,
yes.
AJ Styles versus the Pope,
then, yeah.
Then I'm completely wrong.
I would agree with you there.
But if they have Team Angle versus Team Anderson in a Lockdown, and that's what they're building the pay-per-view around, then that's the headlining main event.
What would correspond to building the pay-per-view? Does it have to be on their poster? Does it have to be when they show commercials? That's the last thing you see?
No, when you see that the headlining main event is going to be whoever's going to be on the two posters. If the Pope and AJ are the two biggest pictures, that's the headliner.
Got it. Okay.
Go back to WrestleMania when it was Hogan versus Rock. The main event was really
Triple H
and Jericho.
Right.
True.
But who was on the poster? Icon versus Icon. You're laughing, but you know I'm right.
You're splitting hairs.
Right. And
no,
you know, hey,
but
we wanted to give you enough rope
but
to
hey,
hang
no,
yourself.
No.
Technically, you're right.
Absolutely.
And technically, you're wrong.
No, technically, I'm
no,
right.
No, you're right.
Hey, here's the thing.
Dave, you're right, too. I'm just trying to give you a hard
I will
time.
Give D'Angelo De Niro, the Pope. I am shocked.
It came out of
I
nowhere.
I couldn't believe. Well, of course. But here's the thing. You know, Damian and I were in Madison. And we met up with a few of the guys, you know, afterwards, and we talked to them about, you know, the Pope, and I talked about my prediction. And there were four or five guys on the Raw roster that says there's no way the Pope would ever win that tournament. So
it shows how much they know.
So, I mean, obviously.
I mean, that doesn't show what you know. It shows what they don't know.
A lot of people were very surprised about it. I even got some texts last night. They're like, wow, you know, couldn't believe it. So, but hey, you know what? Congratulations to the Pope. I hope that they do business right way and reward him the way he should be. But just looking at the makeup of TNA, I don't see them pushing him as one of their top stars.
Dave Hero, I'm actually 100% with you on this the whole way. I just had to let you know that. And again, we gave you enough rope to hang yourself to give you that whole speech. Nobody stepped on you. He'll let you go. I just have to let you know though that. No matter how you spin it, no matter how you spin the hamster wheel, no matter what kid you got bringing in doing little gimmicks, Dave Hero was still wrong.
No, I'm not wrong yet.
Not wrong yet.
We'll see what happens at Lockdown.
Okay,
you can't say he's wrong because it hasn't happened yet.
Oh, I did. I can read into the future just like Dave thought he could.
I'll leave it at that. Rashi, are you surprised by the Pope winning?
By the way, Ring of Honor's next big thing,
yes.
Rashi Brown, the Skull Crusher.
Literally. Surprised, no, because when you watch him on TV, there's something about him that's very charismatic that he lacked in WWE.
Yeah.
Which I'm pretty sure they bottled him up and wouldn't let him do.
Made him a condensed version of himself?
Yeah. I mean, you can tell he's having fun out there, and he's just doing what he wants to do, and I think the crowd feeds off of that. And I don't think that they are going to hold him down because of anything. I think he's making himself a star.
Okay.
That's what I think.
But can he beat AJ Styles and Ric Flair?
Why not?
They got too much invested in
AJ. He's the Pope. The Pope can do anything, right?
The Pope is pimping.
Okay. Answer me this then.
AJ and Flair are connected, but who's more connected than a Pope?
Right. But answer
the,
me
the
this.
Mafia
when the Monday Night Wars start, is the Pope going to be the face of your company?
Why can't he be? If you're introducing a new audience to new characters.
Good point.
And he's the first one you see, and you're attracted to his character.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure he's doing something that's a lot better than you see on WWE. And everybody that watches WWE, they already know what they're going to see when they watch Raw. So if you switch over and you see a different character, or you say, oh, he used to be here, but, man, look at this dude now. You got a new fan. I mean, I think he can do that.
I understand where you're going, Dave, but I believe in what Rashi's saying. Again, it's a whole new life, a whole new energy, you know, a different persona, something that has some energy to it, not the straight flatline thing that we're getting, you know, from day to day. And, you know, it's funny that, you know, Elijah Burke or D'Angelo De Niro, whatever you want to call him now, is what he is now, the pimpin' Pope, or the Pope is pimpin'. Because, again, we've heard this from so many different talents that, you know, they're told not to be so entertaining.
Yep.
They have a new place where they can be as entertaining as their person allows them to be. And, man, we've got guys blowing up already. I mean, guys in GLCW, guys in TNA just getting to do their entertaining thing.
Look at Ken Anderson.
Anderson.
He's not being held back at all anymore.
No.
Anymore.
Well, keep in mind.
I'm not very happy with Ken right now. Just so you know.
Because he put all the
heat on
you?
If he would have beaten the Pope last night, everything would be just fine. And I told him that today. I called him, like, hey. I go, you're making me look bad. He's like, how do you think I feel? I put the guy over, you know?
But so what? He's got to be happy about it because, you know what? He knows that there's still something down the road for him anyway. So it's an honor to do it because he's the one that was there to get the Pope to that next level. So there's honor in that.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Sure.
Overall, against all odds, thumbs up, thumbs down, or in the middle?
Take a look at me now. Oh.
What do you think?
Oh, not the Phil Collins song.
I thought it was
no.
pretty solid. I thought it was, you know what? Anytime you can see the Nasty Boys and Jimmy Hart, you know
just
it's going to be awesome.
January 4th, Hulk Hogan comes on that show and basically says, you know, hey, guys, we're trying something new. We're pushing the new stars. Goes on conferences to the public and says, we're pushing new guys, we're doing this, and then you give
the best thing was when Brian Knobbs grabs the mic and says, I know you all think I'm here because I'm Hulk Hogan's buddy.
Well, no kidding.
It's like, absolutely. You know?
Of course we
and
all
then when
that.
Jimmy Hart comes out, come on, that's great. That's good TV.
No.
You know what it is? If you just take it with a grain of salt, which is all it's worth.
You have to.
You just can't help but sit back and smile and say, hey, this was funny.
There are some things that you can sit there and be angry about, and it's like nepotism or whatever you want to call it. But
it's a good
the
word.
Nasty Boys are entertaining. I mean, you don't expect them to come in there and be the British Bulldogs. You know what I mean?
But true. But remember, Roshan, what they're doing is they're taking away talent that they're trying to push for the future.
No.
Because the Nasty Boys are not the future.
Let me explain something to you.
Have you met Frank? Because Frank's up in your face right now.
If it's not going to be the Nasty Boys, it'll be two more of his buddies. So
Beefcake and Valentine.
Don't tell me that. This slot's available for.
I was going to say, you're saying Hogan's buddy slot?
No.
So it could be, again,
but
what
you have
saying?
To agree that they are not the future of TNA. That's not what they're trying.
Is Ric Flair?
But Ric Flair has a
yes
history.
Yes or no?
No.
The Nasty Boys have a history also.
Not on the same level
what,
as Ric Flair.
Every person can't be the future of a company. I mean, is the Big Show the future of the WWE?
He was at St. Valentine's Day Massacre.
10 years ago.
Right.
I mean, everybody's at a different stage in their career in every company they work in. So you're not bringing the Nasty Boys there to, you know, bring them down the road for 3 or 4 years.
Yeah.
You're bringing the Nasty Boys there for a short run, 6 months or a year or so. You need the star power of the name for people to remember that name and they start switching to watch that channel. But they're not there for the future. They don't need them for the future. The Nasty Boys know this. Everyone there knows this.
Yeah.
We're here while Hogan's here. When he's gone, we're gone for 10 more years, and we'll come back when we're 72 in some other company. Here
you work.
When people are flipping through the channels and they see Team 3D against the Nasties, they're like, wow, there's the Nasty Boys.
They'll watch because
I'll tell you that
I can't remember those guys.
It's getting fast-forwarded,
exactly.
True.
That's what you're
doing.
Looking for. You're looking for the casual fan, and you just answered your own question, I think.
Possibly. It bothers me, but
you're
correct.
You're getting hot about it, Frank. Don't
have you
hot.
Met Frank Costantino? Because he's in charge of the show tonight. Frank, don't we have to go do something?
We do have to take a break. When we come back, WWE ticket giveaway. If you live in Milwaukee, and we'll also a Romine's giveaway. And then later on, we will talk about what happened on SmackDown, on Raw tonight with Jerry Springer as the host. We are broadcasting live from the Time Warner Cable Studios in downtown Milwaukee. You're listening to the Pro Wrestling Report on 540 ESPN at ESPNMilwaukee.com. This Sunday, it's the WWE's Elimination Chamber pay-per-view, and you can watch it on 50 TVs, including the 5 mega screens at Romine's on 27th and College. You should be doing this, Meat. You should be in this chair doing this giveaway. I can't say Romine's, but they're closed today anyway because it's – oh, no. But they're not closed on Sunday. Right now, it's your chance to win the best seats in the house. 4 of the best seats in the house and a $25 food and beverage voucher. It can be yours, but you got to live in southeastern Wisconsin. 414-276-ESPN. That's 414-276-3776. Third caller right now gets the best seats in the house at Romine's. It's 27th and College this Sunday, and don't forget, the Horny Goat beer is just for $2.50. That's right, only $2.50. Could be yours. 414-276-3776. Call now for the best seats in the house.
Don't go messing with a man named me, a man named me, a man named me. Don't you mess with a man named me. That'll be the last time we hear the song.
Yeah, this is
we're
Meathead's,
gonna play next week just for you.
Wedding song. When him and his wife have their first dance together in 88
yeah.
days. Yeah, it'll be this one.
Yeah.
Hey, how's that bachelor party contest going? Did you hear about this last week?
No.
If you go to pbrshow.com and you send an email to Damien explaining why you should be at Meathead's bachelor party, we're gonna pick one lucky person to be his wingman.
Now, would you honestly call that person lucky?
Actually, you don't know me outside of the wrestling thing that we do, Rashi. I'm a wild man. It'll be a good time.
It's going to be here in Milwaukee.
Like I said.
Roughly.
414-276-ESPN, 800-990-ESPN, PWRshow.com. And the Chatmosphere
Is always blowing up. It's at capacity, actually. I thought capacity was 50. But maybe Damien changed that because he knew that Rashi was going to be here tonight, and he opened up the Chatmosphere more for Rashi and Al Snow. DRJ said, Miz, really, Dave Hero, really? Really? You're pulling a Meat Torso. Really?
I'm not pulling
Admit
a Meat Torso.
Admit you were wrong. Admit it. The Pope headline.
Hey,
I suspect
listen.
An Anderson versus Pope rematch soon.
Listen.
By the way, Rashi, thank you.
Before lockdown.
With the Meat Torso, thanks.
Well, you are what you are.
It is
when
what it
lockdown
is.
Happens.
Eat what you eat.
And if he is the headliner, I will apologize to the world. And I
you should take
I
a pie to the face.
Wait a minute. Wait
have to take a pie to the face.
Wait a minute. Why would you have to apologize if you're just making a prediction?
You know what? You're right, Frank. But obviously, you know.
If you're, if
they,
you're
hey, listen. Ever
my
since,
prediction is that he would never headline a pay-per-view. You're not saying.
You don't have to apologize. You can say I was wrong.
Yeah. You know what it is? Ever since the whole Sheamus and the Bret Hart versus Vince McMahon. They've
you're
all
getting it right.
Been
you're
waiting.
Getting it right.
They've all been waiting for everything.
Well, that's what happens, Dave, when you're right a lot.
And you know what it is? Let's face it. They just all wish they could have had Valentine's Day with Gail Kim and Alicia Fox.
There you go.
You know? That's what it comes down to.
Second hour of the program.
Hey, turn that off, okay? Champ?
That was a dude. He needed a box.
That's $10.
Just
yeah.
Next time that rings, it's $10.
Everything else is turned off.
Yeah, like
you know
your
what?
Wife.
If you haven't been following Rashi Brown on Facebook yet, you need to follow him because he put out a bit of wisdom last week, one that I won't be following.
We'll take your phone calls, 414-276-ESPN, 800-990-ESPN. Yes, sir.
You know what? There was hot news from Saturday night also.
We're doing that now or are we doing it in
well,
the next segment?
Whenever you want, but it's about Chris Masters owning. Not to mention Chris Masters, but Hornswoggle also owned
all of what
Damian Nelson.
Six? How tall is Hornswoggle?
Yeah. It was
three,
crazy.
3'6"?
Yeah, it goes up to about my waist, I think. Yeah, 3'6".
Okay.
It was hot news. It was tremendous. I mean, I wish you guys could have been there to see the look on Damian's face.
You have to quit teasing us. What happened?
Well, yeah. What happened is, you know, so after the house show in Madison, you know,
which was a Rob Brand house show,
we go back, you know, and we go and meet up with, a few of the stars and whatnot, and Chris Masters walks into the hotel, and, you know, we're talking because Chris has worked on some GLCW shows in the past.
Correct.
And he looks at Damian. He's like, hey, you look familiar. And Damon's like, oh, you know, I've worked on some of Dave's GLCW shows. He's like, no. He goes, you look really familiar. And Damon's like, well, I did the PWR show. He's like, yeah, that's it. You've buried me on your show. And the utter look of fear in Damian's face, like his heart just dropped.
He probably saw the pick turn.
You know?
I didn't mean it.
Like, yeah, you buried me. And then
taking it out of context.
He looked at Evan Bourne and Yoshitatsu. He's like, yeah. You know, it's a new show, but it's all about wrestling. And, you know, he buried me. And then I looked at Damian, and he just shook his head, and it was great. And then, you know, they talked about the show and whatnot. And, you know, I was surprised to see how many of the guys actually do listen and watch the mm-hmm. show, whereas they'll download it on iTunes, take it on the plane with them, and they'll watch it. But I will say this, Meathead, they want to know why we pay you. They're like, you really pay that guy to be on the show?
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, well, you know, we got to help him out once in a while.
But they don't understand. And now this is for those of you that are listening. I do things behind the scenes as well. I am here to help. I have missed one show in this radio program's history. One show. And trust me, I was fighting to get out of that hospital bed.
No.
To get down
and,
here to
and
the
that's
studio.
What they asked us. They're like, why is he always on?
Because it's what he does.
Nobody gives a damn about you.
So, but yeah, I mean, it was a good time. Oh, and then also, Hornswoggle completely owned Damian Nelson. We're sitting, you know, ringside for the show.
Yeah.
Hornswoggle comes out from under the ring while DX is in there, looks at Damian, points at him, and whips a glow stick at him and smacks him dead center in the chest. And gave him the DX chop and then ran around the ring. It's like, wow. First he gets owned by Horny. And then, you know, Chris Masters, yeah. See what happens?
They're listening.
They're listening.
I see why you had to go to Mardi Gras.
Absolutely. He had to drink his sorrows away. It's a good thing you weren't there, Meathead, because, you know, Hornswoggle would have nailed you in the head or something.
He can't throw up that high.
Oh.
I'm telling you. You know he listens.
I know he listens.
Better
and
be careful.
Didn't he just have a baby? We congratulated him
yes,
on that,
did.
Right?
Yeah.
Was it
a boy
or a baby?
Girl?
Yep.
Wait a minute.
Not him personally.
Okay,
significant
I was
going to
say, I knew he was, but not.
Stop.
Okay.
That's Rashi Brown from Ring of Honor.
Yeah, it was me.
Inappropriate. Fish swing. Let's go to the phones, line one, and speak to Gilberto from Florida. You're on the Pro Wrestling Report.
Hey, guys. How's it going?
Pretty good.
Gilberto.
Good.
Yeah, I just want to talk about Raw and TNA a little bit. You know, I thought Raw was pretty good tonight. I was kind of confused with Bret Hart, with what they were doing with that, but. You know,
they've got a way. They got about 6 weeks to continue to build that. But did Raw make you want to pay for the Elimination Chamber this week?
Well, I really wasn't going to order it because I feel that Elimination Chamber, ever since they started doing this whole thing where the winner gets into the main event of WrestleMania, I think it makes the Royal Rumble look like nothing because. What's the point of winning the Rumble when somebody else can still get into the
match? The Royal Rumble.
You know, what's the point of that? I mean, usually back, you know, maybe 5 or 6 years ago, they would use the Rumble and have a 3-month build-up with personal feuds that would lead up to WrestleMania.
Right. Yep.
Because last year, you know, nobody even remembers that Randy Orton won the Rumble. It was more about...
That's a good point.
That's true.
Sure.
Yeah.
And you know, TNA, three words, man. Pope is pimping, you know, after last night.
There you go.
You know, it's amazing because if you look at when I saw the pay-per-view at a friend's house. So when
oh,
I saw
so
that,
you stole it, huh?
Not stealing. He paid a cover charge at the door.
Did you at least bring
that was
like...
Meathead's house on his black box.
Stop.
You know, when I saw that they were going to have this Mojo match in AJ Styles at around 10, I said, oh, okay, they're going to have the main event be the finals of the 8-card stud match.
So you're saying that Pope was in the main event?
Yes, I was going to say, who was the one that said that Pope wouldn't main event a TNA pay-per-view?
That was me, and he hasn't main evented
but,
yet.
But here's the thing.
You
have to break it down a little bit different. If he wasn't the advertised main event before Sunday afternoon, that is not what the case was.
Thank you, Rashi Brown.
And you know what? Again, you're absolutely right.
I know.
We're always right. That's the problem.
No. That's not right at all.
Thanks for the phone call, Gilberto. 414-276-ESPN, 800-990-ESPN. Continue
on
the phone.
Hold on a second.
In a moment, yes.
Back in the late 80s when Hogan was wrestling Iron Sheik or Orndorff or Bundy or whoever, and he was on right before intermission.
Yeah.
Who that was the main event.
And then that was the main event. That was the headlining main event. And
Dave,
then
– are you really
going
to get it?
No,
agree with you?
I'm not talking to you right now.
Okay.
I'm talking to everybody else.
There's
and
still
then,
a few people that disagree
that aren't
with
getting
it.
This.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
And then at the end
– the masses.
And then to end the show would be the British Bulldogs against the Hart Foundation because that's how they would, you know, send the people home happy.
Right.
You mean the masses?
Yeah, the fans.
But
the listeners.
I guarantee you on the posters it wasn't the Hart Foundation
nope.
versus the British Bulldogs.
No, it was Hulk Hogan
right.
versus, you know, Piper whoever. Or Adonis
was,
or whoever.
But it was Hogan's face on there the whole time because Hogan
so
was
we it. Hope you understand out there what he's trying to say.
Continue on the phones. Moses in Queens. Moses, you're on the Pro Wrestling Report.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Hey,
good.
Moses.
Hey, Rashi Brown, big props, man. My father and I, we actually went to our first Ring of Honor show in Manhattan.
Yeah.
And let me tell you, man, that flip, I'm sorry, the dive you did over to all the other guys, to Carino and the rest of them, that was badass, bro. So props to that. And
I'm still feeling it, man. My leg and
are
my
you really?
Head. Oh, yeah.
I actually thought you were going to come out of there, you know, winning, you know, props to Delirious for the win, but I really thought you were going to come out with the W, man.
I did, too.
But, you know, all I just want to say is much prop and respect
to
each and every
you.
One of you guys on the PWR, the Cos, David Hero, Meathead, and, of course, Damien, and you too, Rashi. So,
thank you,
keep doing. Yeah. What's up?
Thanks for the call.
You.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem, man. Much respect to you guys, man. Thank you.
Take care, bro.
Call again. Let's continue.
See, he gets it.
He gets it. Continue and speak to Anthony in Helmar, California.
Hey.
Anthony.
Hey there, guys.
Anthony,
how's it going?
What's up?
Go ahead, Anthony.
I thought about calling now since Al Snow's going to probably take up most of the second hour.
Well, hey, I mean, you got to get on to the 2009 Wrestling Broadcast Show of the Year, so if you want to get on and talk before Al gets on, right now is the best time.
And so... Where was she? Rashad and
Rashi.
Sorry, I had a brain fart moment.
That's okay.
And David was saying that if you're not advertised for in the main event, you're not actually in the main event. Correct?
No.
No, because that's true. Then when Hernandez cashed in his title shot at the pay per view, wouldn't that make him in the main event?
What did you say?
Because didn't you say in the previous call that if you were not advertised to be in the main event, you didn't technically be in the main event.
No, I said if you weren't advertised as the main event prior to it being ordered, you were not the headline of the pay-per-view. He was not the reason that you ordered the pay-per-view. You didn't know going in that he would be the main event of the evening.
Right.
No, but the main reason why people wanted to get it was for the world title shot and the tournament final. So technically, he was in the main event.
No, the main event was AJ Styles versus Samoa Joe.
It's always the World Heavyweight Championship match. It should be, unless it's the Royal Rumble.
Or Brock versus Hogan.
All right. It's just going to keep going, so I'm just going to drop it.
there you go.
I'm sorry, my
they're
man.
Learning. Yeah. They're learning.
Just like Tom Petty, I won't back down.
And what did you guys think about the show, Big Show and Miz teaming up, even having new joint music?
I think it's great. I think that they're going to be a solid team. I think The Miz is going to learn a lot from working with Big Show.
Absolutely.
The number one knucklehead.
I think he should have probably Miz lose the belt, the U.S. belt to MVP. Or
you know what? I honestly believe that Miz having all three of those belts is a rib on him. Because you got to figure, when you hit the airport and you got to, like, check your bag.
I can answer this. Yeah. Man.
Because you got to figure those belts are 20 pounds a pop.
We
that's
had to take
60 pounds.
Me and
ain't
my partner,
going through security.
We had to take two belts through security. Man, that is not fun. That oh my god.
And
yeah.
Now when you got to pay when the weight's over on the suitcase.
Yeah.
He's paying at least 100 bucks in luggage.
Southwest.
It doesn't
matter
what the night.
All right, Anthony.
Yeah,
thanks a lot for the phone call.
Thanks.
I want to throw to the chatmosphere right now and go to eMoney0919 just in the same topic. And Dave, this is to you.
Of course. Why wouldn't it be?
I'm just asking. So did Hulk Hogan headline against a lot because he was the poster with the biggest picture? Or on the poster with the biggest picture?
Well, he was a selling point. That's why they used
okay.
him.
Okay. That's what I'm yeah. just throwing that out.
Hey, listen. Like I said, if they put Pope versus AJ on the poster, the you know, as big as they put Hogan on, and that's what they built the show around, then he's the headlining main event.
Yep.
Okay. I'm with you.
I know you are.
Continue
hey,
on the phone.
Just, you know, I'll take every question that comes my way. I'll defend it.
That's what
just
you
like
do
I'll
when
defend
right.
myself if I get asked about that other dumb thing that we're going to get to.
Oh, now he says it's a dumb thing.
It's
what?
Dumb because it keeps on going. The true heel thing hasn't
been
with the rev again.
Oh, God.
I've tried. I tried to ignore
them. You didn't even
them.
Have to bring
you know
it up.
You know what?
It's going
to
come up
we're
when
gonna
Al
have Al
comes
Al's
on.
No, you know,
right.
It'll come
tonight.
Up anyway.
Wait a minute.
We could have waited
and
for
Al. Take 40 minutes.
You know, we can only ask Al one or two questions, so.
And we still have paid spots later, too, so.
it's all about getting your spots in, right, Rashi?
That's what Al told me.
Let's go to Glenn in Orlando. Glenn, you're on the Pro Wrestling Report.
Hey, guys. What's up this week?
Hey, Glenn.
Doing good, Glenn.
I have a question about Sheamus for you guys this week.
All right.
I don't like him. I don't dislike him. I just don't care about him.
Okay.
Explain to me why he's a WWE champion. He did not win the title by pinfall or submission, and he has not defended the title successfully by pinfall or submission yet.
You know, it's funny. As we're talking about the whole Pope thing, and I'm going to move on to this here, you know, Sheamus is the WWE champion, but he's not the main event. Isn't it odd that the champion isn't the main event?
Because.
I mean, we're, it's kind of the same thing.
Know,
that's why I'm throwing
is,
that out there.
The position I'm in is very, very difficult. But
leave it to Dave to answer then.
Why I'm here, so.
Okay.
I'm just
you're the only
do
one that
ladies and
right.
gentlemen, Rashi Brown, the Skull Crusher.
When you can take advantage of someone, when you're in a company, and keep yourself on top and keep the champ buried, you're going to do it.
Yep.
He can't complain. He's very happy. He's a young man. A couple of more months of this, he'll be set for life. So he's not going to rock the boat. There's no issue there.
He'll just take the pay-per-view
and
bonuses
he's learning,
and keep moving.
And he's learning, and they're teaching mm-hmm. him, and they're grooming him. That's Triple H's boy, so they're grooming him.
Yep.
Just ride the wave, and when they move on, he steps up.
And, you know, when you mentioned how he hasn't successfully defended his title yet.
Right.
Back in the 80s, how many times did Ric Flair successfully defend his title? It was always a DQ or a count out or something.
What did they call it?
No,
job or whatever?
Or the dusty finish?
Dusty finish.
Flair would go, you know,
and
time
I'm not
time limit draw.
I'm not comparing
Flair
to Sheamus.
You can compare Sheamus to maybe, but they're totally different gimmicks, the Honky Tonk Man.
There you go.
That's
yeah.
a good point.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, so I'm not comparing Sheamus and Flair. I don't want anyone start, you know,
yeah,
saying
yeah.
that. But the same thing. A heel champion, very seldom do they ever beat somebody pinfall.
That's why you need enhancement, guys.
Absolutely. Meathead, applications.
I told you I'm done being trampled on this program.
How are you being trampled? You've been getting a lot of love.
He's our enhancement guy.
Yeah, right?
You know what? I don't mind being the butt of jokes. If that's what that is, yeah, you know what? I get it. I'm cool with that. As long as I'm doing my job, I don't really care.
You are.
Before the break, let's speak to Matt in Kenosha. Matt, you're on the Pro Wrestling Report.
Hey, guys. How's it going?
Hey, Matt.
Good,
welcome
Matt.
To the program.
I'm just curious to know what you think about the Survivor Series being become a WCW brand. Talking about WWE going to, like, a wrestler sort of thing with the...
Funk is not the Battle Bowl that they were talking about, too.
Yeah,
that was terrible.
The idea of the War Games with that group, what do you think?
The War Games is always cool, man.
Yeah.
I loved it.
And I have to apologize because I'm the one that set Damian off on an interactive episode where we started talking about War Games, and I said, yeah, the three cages and the three commentary teams, I confused it with World War III. That
yeah,
was
no,
my
that's
fault.
That's different.
Yeah.
War, if they kept the original, you know they're going
to
change
games
the
used
concept
to be in
and make it their own.
Yeah.
If
but
they do it.
If they do it. But the original concept with one man in, one man in, one man in,
mm-hmm.
that was great. Not 5 men in and then you go. And no one could, the match didn't start until all 10 men were in or
right.
8 men or whatever. That
so it was just
great.
A Donnybrook until it started.
Right.
Yeah, again, so I apologize.
I'm going to miss the Survivor Series.
Well, they never treated
it
as like a real
Survivor
Series.
In so long.
Yeah. The traditional, or that.
That's
right.
Hey, you know what, though? I'm still going to miss it. That's, you know.
And the Ultimate Survivor. Survivor was one of my favorites, where you had the winners of all the Survivor Series matches going into the final.
Oh,
I thought that was cool.
A CBS show.
Yes.
Rob Elliott, hang on. We'll get to you when we come back. We'll also talk about what happened on Raw. We also have a giveaway for two tickets to WWE SmackDown here in Milwaukee.
Milwaukee.
Going to be in southeastern Wisconsin to win. We're broadcasting live from the Time Warner Cable Studios in downtown Milwaukee. You're listening to the Pro Wrestling Report on 540 ESPN at ESPNMilwaukee.com. All right.
Yeah, man.
Welcome back to the Pro Wrestling Report on 540
cool.
ESPN, ESPNMilwaukee.com. Honky Tonk Man was thought of being in the Hall of Fame or something. That
wow,
didn't
yeah.
happen.
No.
Obviously didn't happen.
He turned it down.
Honky Tonk does not want to be worked, man.
He also
real.
Said that he also said, and he put this out there, he had a prior commitment at, I think it was a Comic-Con.
Wizard World
Wizard
in
World.
Toronto.
Yeah, it wasn't a Comic-Con. It was a Wizard World, but they were paying more.
Well,
there
that
was
is
more
a Comic-Con.
Booking. Yeah, they were paying more and more bookings, so forth. So he said, why would I also, you know, turn down a commitment I already made? So
I mean,
you got to appreciate the businessman in him.
He still earns a living out here, man. You can't make him not
yeah.
work for 3 months. That's just crazy. I mean,
yeah, because mm-hmm. there's a no-compete once you're
yeah.
in the Hall of Fame. Frank?
Let's go to the phones. Elliot in Queens, you're on the Pro Wrestling Report.
Hey, guys.
Hey,
Elliot. How are you?
First, I got to give a shout-out to Rashi. I saw the 8th anniversary show at the Hammerstein Ballroom. Amazing match. Amazing show.
Thank you, sir.
Great show. Best show I've seen live in a while.
That Austin Aries and, oh, my God, that Austin Aries and Tyler Black match.
Jesus. No, the Davey Richards, El Generico.
Well, they were both great.
Yeah, how are you gonna go wrong on that?
I can't say which. I can't say any match on the show which was great, but you know that's neither here nor there.
Right.
I have a lot of faith. I gotta say, I got a lot of faith in two guys in TNA. That is the Pope and Desmond Wolfe.
Pippin.
The Pope is next to Anderson. I see is can reach rock status.
Breakout.
I think between him and Anderson are the only two that can reach rock status, and I believe that Desmond Wolfe is a Triple H in the making. I might be
The Rock? No, he said Desmond Wolfe, or as you used to call him, Wolfie, when you didn't like him.
Yeah, I might be condemned for this, but he has the swagger to him. You know,
not a Jack swagger, but just a swagger.
No, I don't know what they're gonna do with him, but he just has something about him that screams cocky world champion. I watched him back in ROH. Like,
yeah, I enjoy him a lot, man.
You know, when I first started watching ROH towards the end of his run as champion, brilliant stuff. Even his last promo on the show was just amazing. Like, he has the skills. Him and the Pope are, like, breakout stars there. And I'm really looking forward to what they do with them. It's just amazing. You know, it's just...
By the way, we've been hit through our Twitter page. Thank you for the call. By the way, we've been hit through our Twitter page and our Facebook page as well. Desmond Wolfe does not do a flip with his hand. It's just a slap up the peace sign. I thought he twisted his wrist when he did it, but it's just a straight peace sign. So it's British for flipping people off, I guess.
Let's go to Rob in New Jersey. Rob, you're on the Pro Wrestling Report.
David, you have some explaining to do.
What was that?
You have some explaining to do. No, guys, how you guys doing?
Good. Doing fine. Rob, you almost got dumped there, but welcome back.
Yeah, thank you. I thought I was cut off. I thought you guys didn't like me.
No, it's okay. Go ahead.
Like me.
Okay, guys. Well, first of all, I want to talk about, you know, the Pope. I Facebooked David last night saying, you know, basically that the Pope is, he's kind of, you know, he's making his way up. And I have to agree with that last caller about, you know, everything. And I have to say that the Pope literally is going to be a main event. Just don't know when, but he will be. And I guarantee you that, David.
Hey, if I'm wrong, I'll admit I'm wrong. I'm not wrong yet.
All right, guys. Can you tell me what about the Pope that intrigued you?
Oh, God, dude, did you see his promo on Orlando Jordan?
You talking about the January 4th one? on the big
he
show.
He got pimp slapped, okay? He got pimp slapped. And number two, I really got to like the Pope's, he has a lot of charisma.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
And he oozes charisma, actually.
I don't know how they bottle that up in New York.
Oh, the second thing I want to talk about, gentlemen, is tonight on the Jerry Springer show. Basically, I know the cobra, and how does a cobra and a leprechaun actually get some, you know? Come on.
And thanks for the call.
I have no idea.
It was a bringing up the point with Jerry Springer hosting tonight. It was a weird program. I'm not going to say it was good or bad.
It was just making fun of a Jerry show, the paternity test. You know what? Some people thought that, Kaz, you were the father of Kelly Kelly's baby.
Yeah.
Blanchard Buzz, he shot me a tweet saying, hey, I thought Kaz was the guy.
I'm just happy that
Frank
Costantino is here to host because, you know, on the Frank fan page, we've been waiting for Frank to be back on the show.
What, the three people that are there?
Frank, do you know how many followers you have on Twitter?
I have no idea.
You have over 80.
That's 78 too many.
That's tremendous.
And he hasn't tweeted since the first Packer-Viking game.
You know what? I'm a little disturbed about one thing.
What's that? Fans are
saying that the Pope is like the next Rock.
Why are you disturbed? This is the people talking, man.
That's the Rock.
No, this is what you look for in a company. TNA, Ring of Honor, WWE, you should all be listening. This is what people want, and they're telling you what they like. So for you to not understand what someone that wants to give money to a business likes.
I'm cool with that, but it's just saying they're comparing him to one of the top guys in the world of wrestling.
They have that opinion. They can do that. Why not?
But I guess what Rashid's trying to say to you, Dave, and for everyone is, TNA right now has fans that are excited about somebody in their company.
No, and that's great. I think that's awesome. And believe
going
me,
after your
I've gotten
demigod.
All of the emails, tweets, and Facebooks about it in the past 24 hours.
You've had to charge your battery three times a day.
You know what, and that's great. But
so who did they compare The Rock to when he was coming up?
I don't know who
Dad.
Did.
And then do you say, oh, that's absurd. You can't. And when The Rock first started, you can't say he was great.
No, he wasn't.
Right.
Not even close to great.
But you saw
like
the
that.
Charisma, but he wasn't great. So for someone to say, oh, The Rock's the next this at that time, you probably
never
would
said
laugh.
That about The Rock.
Oh, my God. Stop it. When they pushed him down our throats when he first came
on TV. You're talking about
TV,
that Rock Bottom pay-per-view?
Rocky Maivia when he had
when
the
No,
I'm talking about even when he was the heel. When even he was a heel and he took over to December pay-per-view and named it Rock Bottom. It's my pay-per-view. That's when he was the strongest heel because he was a champion and he had his own pay-per-view.
No, but I'm saying I don't remember them ever saying The Rock was the next whoever.
Why not? They had plans
for him.
I'm just saying.
I don't remember them ever saying that.
I think they compared him more to his dad.
No, I don't
know.
You don't think?
No.
Because they brought up
they
his
never
dad,
said
they
that The Rock was the next. It was more.
I'm with Dave on this one. They never said he was the anything. They just they
well, I'm just
did
saying,
shove him down.
Well, okay, but it wasn't a fan.
The same thing with Austin. You know, they never said he's the next whoever.
So they caught lightning in a bottle twice in the same era.
They did.
Well, they got like three or four times. Because then you throw in DX.
I mean, you can compare him to anybody you want to. I mean, it's your God-given right.
You know what?
But
I can see the Pope turning into the next Kofi Kingston.
But now that's why you're a moron. Why? Because he's black?
Rocky Kofi.
No.
It's not a race thing.
Well,
there's 8 billion wrestlers in the history of the planet Earth, and then you compare him to Kofi Kingston.
Here's why. Because Kofi got a quick push. They put a rocket on his back, shot him to the moon against Randy Orton, and now he just put over Ted DiBiase 2 months later.
No.
That's what I'm saying.
But are people oozing on the phone line saying, we need Kofi?
They absolutely did.
No, there were people that were excited that Kofi was next, and they assumed he was next. But there are people oozing right now about how pimpin' the Pope
different.
Is.
This is a buzz,
After
man.
The
this
lockdown
is...
pay-per-view, I'll be back to normal again.
Okay.
Whatever.
You don't seem to understand.
Before the top of the hour, let's speak to Jason in Tennessee. Jason, you're on the Pro Wrestling Report.
Hey guys, what's up?
Hey Jason.
Before I get to my question, I gotta say I'm hopping on the Pope bandwagon, and I don't think he's
the Pope-mobile.
What?
Frank made a joke. Just
go ahead.
Go.
It was a bad joke.
I liked it, Frank.
I
Anyway, I'm going to say that I don't think he's going to be the next Brock, but I think he will be the next D'Angelo De Niro, and that's what.
Thank you, man.
And
the first D'Angelo De Niro.
Isn't it better
to
be the first something than the next
thing? Thank that
you.
I like. Thank
you like
you.
That line?
I like. Oh,
copyright
no,
made in 2010.
Sure. That's it, right there.
Thank you, Jason, for the phone call.
You're the smartest guy in the room right now. Well, I'm back in the room now again, so go ahead. I just got back.
We got about a minute left here. TNA to Monday nights. We're going to talk about that second hour. Also with Al
Snow. The first hour is already up. Are you kidding me?
Just
yeah.
About.
Ladies
just
and gentlemen,
about.
Stay tuned for the Al Snow Show brought to you by the Pro Wrestling Report.
But we will. It is your chance to talk to Al Snow. Now, with TNA going to Monday nights, and I don't know exactly when they're going to do it.
It's going to happen the first of the month. Is Head coming along with Al as well?
We will find out.
Okay.
But Al Snow was wrestling at the time of the Monday Night Wars.
Yes.
So who better to talk to him about that if you got a question?
And at one time, Al was even rumored to be leaving to go to Nitro.
Yeah.
That was when Russo and Ferrer left.
Mm-hmm.
We also, second hour, will have a SmackDown ticket giveaway for those people in the southeastern Wisconsin. We'll get into the Elimination Chamber, which is WWE's pay-per-view this Sunday. We'll quickly run through who we think will win. Jewel's going to host Raw next week. You happy? We'll talk about that. You're listening to the Pro Wrestling Report, 540 ESPN and ESPNMilwaukee.com. Stick around.
We'll do it live! Do it live! I'll write it and we'll do it live! Thing sucks!
You see, KYJ, things have changed just a little bit since the last time you were here.
I think you should see your oculus. Nothing wrong with my feet. I'm talking about your eyes.
I can even make my ass do tricks. Watch this.
You have any idea where you are? You're in the jungle, baby. This is WCW. That's right. Hold on.
For over 10 years, the world's number one source for professional wrestling news and information. And once again, here's your hosts, Damian Nelson, Frank Cosentino, and the man they call Meathead. This is the Pro Wrestling Report on 540 ESPN.
Second hour of the Pro Wrestling Report, 540 ESPN and ESPNMilwaukee.com. If you want to join the program, you can at 414-276-3776. All over the world at 800-990-3776. A little bit later on, we will be giving away two tickets to WWE SmackDown here in Milwaukee. Got to live in southeastern Wisconsin. You're going to have to pick those things up. But we will be giving that away very soon.
You know what's going on Sunday?
There is something going on Sunday here in Milwaukee at the Milwaukee Admirals game. Dave.
Body slams on ice.
Which one is this now? I mean, you're not numbering them anymore, are you? Because there's not really the matches over
I think it's number 9.
But, I mean, it's not like we're, you know, lowering the ring on top of the ice.
No, not anymore. Now it's a meet and greet.
Right, before the show.
It's a tribute to wrestling night for the Admirals.
Oh, nice.
Christy Hemme.
Yep.
Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
Oh! Frank, what do you think about
AWA
Hacksaw?
AWA legend.
Still hurts.
Frank almost got choked out by Hacksaw.
Billy Robinson.
The legendary Billy Robinson.
First time in 25 years he's
been
made his return to Milwaukee.
Really?
And, of course, the guy that was at the very first Body Slams on Ice, and our very good, close, personal friend, Al Snow.
And let's get Al on the phone right now. Al, good evening.
Howdy do, guys.
We're doing good. Thanks for taking the time. You're guest hosting here, so.
Well, I appreciate you guys having me on, you know, but. I'm excited. There are parts of my body that are pulling up inside of me right now as we speak, just because
like
of
a
the level
turtle.
Of excitement to being on the air with you guys.
Wow.
Like a frightened turtle.
And again, if you do have a question for Al, you can call in at 414-276-ESPN, 800-990-ESPN. Anything wrestling related or anything that you have
anything.
In mind?
What about Uncle
anything
Al's advice on life?
We can solve all the mysteries of life tonight here on ESPN Radio.
Well, then we better get Cousin Jack on the air then with us, too.
yes. Man of mystery, average Joe. Yes.
Well, you're going to be in Milwaukee this coming weekend.
Yes, I am.
And
What have you been up to these days besides seeing – well, we've seen you a few times lately in here in the Milwaukee area, but what is Mr. Snow up to these days?
Well, you know, kids' parties, doing magic tricks, balloon animals, things like that. still wrestling professionally, and then I've been getting into acting. I've been just got done doing a major motion picture directed by Lee Scott over in Connecticut called Witches of Oz. It's like a remake of a modern remake or renewal of The Wizard of Oz.
Okay.
And it stars Christopher Lloyd and Billy Boyd from Lord of the Rings and Eliza Swenson and Barry Ratcliffe and quite a few other people. So, and then, you know, myself.
That's pretty exciting stuff there.
Al, is there any truth to the rumor that you have a fight scene with the Tin Man?
Yes, I do. I am Gnome King, and me and my gnomies, it was the greatest thing. I just thanked the director, Lee Scott, because, you know, they were filming the big battle scene between the gnomes and the munchkins. And, you know, so it was like a midget royale. Fighting everywhere, smoke, you know, trash, in like two little midgets were on top of a cop car attacking each other with little tiny swords. Oh, it was just brilliant, absolutely brilliant.
We're speaking with Al Snow on the Pro Wrestling Report, 540 ESPN and ESPNMilwaukee.com. Al, is there a certain role that you would be looking for in the future when it comes to movies? Is there a certain character you'd like to play?
No, I mean, I've played lately a lot of killers and drug dealers and drug dealing killers.
Do you think that has anything to do with the look? Yeah. Is it the look that's typecasting you right now, Al?
It's your background in pro wrestling, man.
Yeah, I don't know, man. There's some different characters I'm going to do coming up here in the near future, and I'm looking forward to doing those. And I considered being Jesus, but I think I'd be a terrible Jesus. You know, what with turning water into wine, I'd be drunk all the time. So.
Hey, Al, that reminds me. You got to tell the world about your show after Christmas in Ohio, Jesus versus Santa Claus.
Oh, okay. Well, since Dave brought it up.
And remember, we are live.
I will listen.
And this is terrestrial radio. The FCC does listen.
Yes. I will make it PG.
Okay.
So don't worry. I just want to, you know, I gave myself a Christmas present, and, you know, what with my now interest in acting and the cinematic arts, I decided that after Christmas I went to a wrestling show / speed metal, you know, concert or something like that at a bar in Sandusky, Ohio, which, of course, you know, if anybody would imagine, you know, somebody who would be a greater fan of speed metal than me, I can't know if there's anybody out there. I have to be honest with the state of professional wrestling sometimes not only disheartens me, but on verge of aggravation sometimes. But I've decided that I will rise above this, and I will find a way to carry on and to find the sunshine in this troubled and turmoiled world of professional wrestling, and this was a good example of it. I was picked up by my handlers and taken to the show, and they were describing last year's event, where apparently Jesus Christ had our Lord and Savior had wrestled Santa Claus, and apparently. Last year, Jesus, the most over baby face in the history of wrestling, needed the assistance of a referee to strike Santa with a chair to defeat Santa. I was a bit stunned by this, but and only more chagrined by the fact that they were having a rematch of this epic struggle the day after Christmas with Jesus taking on Santa. So immediately when I arrived to the building, I searched out Jesus, which, you know, all of us do. We all try to find our personal savior. But I found my personal savior in Sandusky, Ohio at bar.
Okay.
Standing half naked in the locker room. alongside Santa Claus. Now, I began to delve into what they had planned for this incredible rematch and was extremely disappointed when I found out that their plan was to just simply have like a double knockout. And I said, no, this cannot do. You don't understand that in 28 years of my being involved in the circus world of professional wrestling, never, and I do say with unequivocally, never have I ever seen Jesus Christ wrestling Santa Claus. So I said, this we have to take to a new level, boys. I said, you are standing on the precipice of immortality. Little Jesus, of course, you, obviously, and Santa, you've been around for a very long time, but not nearly as long as Jesus, and for obvious reasons. So we have to take this to the next level. So I spent about a half an hour to 45 minutes being a used car salesman, and boy, do I wish they'd have videotaped that, as I addressed Jesus and Santa and convinced Santa to be willing to allow Jesus to taser, actually take an electrical taser and taser Santa to win the match. Conversation would go stumbling like this, where I almost had Santa on the hook. Jesus, of course, wanting to turn the other cheek, would say, "Oh, I don't know about that." And I'd say, "Jesus, for God's sake, it's not going to kill Santa. He'll be okay. Now, Santa, listen to me. It'll be all right. Just take it right in the stomach one time. Then you take another one in the stomach. You'll be okay." So after quite a bit of talking, we were able to film my Passion of the Christ 2, the night that Jesus tasered Santa, where Jesus was crucified during the match, a crown of barbed wire thorns put on his head. Of course, he had to be brought near death and then resurrected, came back, fought, did the big comeback, took the tasered Santa in the stomach, and then the second time caught him in the right testicle. he beat Santa, and then the reluctant Jesus in the locker room suddenly must have been possessed by Satan, because when I began to chant it one more time, had no problem, Jesus had no problem applying the taser quite heavily to Santa's right kidney, which made Santa pee his pants. So Santa proceeded to kick Jesus in the crotch and roll out of the ring. So I was then able to convince Jesus that, revenge is mine, saith the Lord, an eye for an eye, and Santa had to taser Jesus in the locker room as retribution for the wetting himself in the ring. So,
And, of course, Al, you can post all that great video on your Facebook page later tonight.
Yeah, I videotaped all of that on my phone, and I did put it up on the Facebook, so I'll have to put it up there again. So.
Well, I'm looking right now.
It's up there somewhere. Probably one of the older posts. So you'll see it. It is priceless.
I think I'm supposed to go to confession after listening to that whole story.
Well, everybody louds Mel Gibson as some kind of genius. But listen, he didn't have our Lord and Savior tasering a pagan deity right there at the damn Christmas. I mean, come on. So,
we're speaking with Al Snow on the Pro Wrestling Report, 540 ESPN and ESPNMilwaukee.com. Al, I want to switch gears a little bit, talk Monday Night Wars. It was just mentioned that TNA.
You just want to depart the whole Jesus Santa thing?
Yes, so we're going to depart the Red Sea with Moses and all of that. TNA has decided to go to Monday Night, go right up against WWE. And,
yeah, I believe that was the plan right from the onset. Bischoff wanted to do that, take it head-to-head with them.
You were part of the quote-unquote Monday Night Wars back then, and talk a little bit about the competition, and did it make you a better wrestler? Did it make people around you better? Was it talked about in the locker room? Talk a little bit about that time.
Well, it was talked about constantly, the competition was great. I mean, it really helped the wrestling business as a whole. It's so beneficial for the fans because it ups everybody's product, and it is beneficial for the wrestlers. There are other opportunities and other options instead of just being one sole vehicle to make a living. It's better for the promotions themselves and the promoters and the writers. It forces everybody to up their game. And I think it would be a great boon, to the wrestling business as a whole if TNA can mount some type of quantifiable offense against, WWE and their rule on Monday night. I think that would just be fantastic. And, and deep down, I really think that Vince McMahon would love to have that too,
yeah.
Would love to have somebody to fight with and to compete with. He thrives on that.
Yep.
He loves that challenge. And he hasn't had it for a very long time. So,
Al, two of the bigger up-and-coming stars on both brands, on Raw you have The Miz, on TNA they have The Pope, Elijah Burke. You were pretty influential with both of those young guys. Did you see the star quality in The Miz and Elijah Burke back when they were in OVW?
Certainly. With Miz and the last Tough Enough, I thought that Miz should have been the guy that should have won. If it had been left up to me, he would have. But it was left up to the fans, and rightfully, Daniel Puder rightfully won because he did a far greater job at marketing himself. And luck was on his side when it came to winning challenges and, creating that perception on TV of his being a star. But what it really came down to is he really went out of his way to market himself and get those votes. But I always thought that Miz should have been the one that won. And after he had lost, I campaigned for him to be hired, and rightfully so. I mean, it's proved out. And Elijah, numerous times I really was disappointed when WWE couldn't seem to find anything for him, and they let him go. It was mind-boggling because I certainly saw he's an incredibly talented individual and has a ton of charisma and just needs the proper direction and can certainly be a star. And
it's funny,
star now, but in years to come, I can see him being a star.
Funny, Al, that you bring that up, too, because we've had the conversation on the show so many times with the guys when they come on about how it seems that they're – charisma, they're told not to be so entertaining, to kind of tone it down and fit this mold that they want for them. And here we see two guys over in TNA right now being allowed to be themselves and be entertaining. And, I mean, they were in the finals last night at the pay-per-view.
Ken Anderson and Elijah
Burke. Yeah, it was the Pope and, Mr. Anderson.
Yeah. I don't know. I can't speak on what they tell them when they go up there to WWE, but
mm-hmm.
it is confusing and does fascinate me that, I see guys with so much potential, and then, they go up there and then they just seem to flounder, and I don't know why, because I know that the big concept is that, it's so different than WWE than it is anywhere else. It's not, there are differences as far as maybe a style or direction, but when that bell rings, after the fireworks are ended, after you walk down the ramp, after the fireworks have ended, the music is shut off, that bell rings, somebody, anybody, tell me what is different there than it is in TNA or any other place that you put three letters together and have two guys in underwear fake fighting each other.
Speaking as two
and
guys
not
in
just
underwear.
Different organizations, tell me what's different today for all of those big proponents that say, there's an old school and a new school. Tell me what was different today when that bell rings at 2010 as it is in 1910.
Mm-hmm.
Other than the audience being of a greater level of sophistication, tell me what is different.
There is no
Tell me
difference.
What's now fake that wasn't fake in 1910.
There isn't.
Go ahead, me. No, go ahead.
Go ahead.
Al, we're going to take a break. When we come back,
okay.
If you have a question for Al Snow, you can call in. And
Maybe you have words of wisdom for Al, as he likes to
Uncle
do on
Al.
Facebook.
Yeah, please give me words of wisdom, because I desperately need them.
And we also have a giveaway. We'll do that when we come back. You're listening to Pro Wrestling Report on 540 ESPN and ESPNMilwaukee.com.
Listen to the game weeknights at 6 on 540 ESPN.
Welcome back to the Pro Wrestling Report on 540 ESPN and ESPNMilwaukee.com. Tuesday night, February 23rd, WWE presents SmackDown and ECW at the Bradley Center.
No. It's NXT. ECW's gone.
That's true, but...
I know.
You're correct. And I will talk to the writing people here at 540 ESPN.
Heads are going to roll.
Get your tickets today for the first SmackDown in ECW. Now see what you made me do?
I'm sorry.
Now I can't say ECW. It's the first event of 2010. The World Heavyweight Championship match will feature The Undertaker versus Batista. It's Tuesday night, February 23rd at the Bradley Center. Tickets start at $15. Get yours now at the box office or Ticketmaster.com. But caller number 3 right now can win tickets to this exciting event. That's caller number 3. The catch is you got to live in southeastern Wisconsin. You don't want to be calling from Nome, Alaska or anything like
that. You got to come and pick up the tickets here at the studio.
That's right. Again, caller number 3 right now, live in southeastern Wisconsin. You get to go to SmackDown this Tuesday night, February 23rd, 414-276-ESPN, 800-990-ESPN are the phone numbers. Right now we're speaking with Al Snow. Again, Al, we appreciate the time that you're giving us this evening.
Ah, thank you guys. I appreciate you allowing me to be on the air with, you know, such a wonderful host as yourself.
We're part of, obviously, about wrestling 20-plus years and so on. And one of the questions of the evening is what TNA is doing against WWE. What do you think would be the biggest challenge that TNA has right now being the quote-unquote underdog, per se? What do you think their biggest challenge is?
Probably the same thing that's facing WWE, too, is just being able to have enough new and properly polished talent that you can now expose to the audience. You can be in the right place at the right time and not have enough of what it is that you need, which is what drives the wrestling business, and that's the wrestlers. I think I've mentioned it before, but anybody can put on a pair of boots and a pair of trunks and be a wrestler, but you need guys that have that experience, that have that understanding of the wrestling business to draw money. You know, I know the new proponent today is that, well, it's a changed business. It's more of a TV product. It's not about live attendance, but it still comes down to your performers or your product being able to motivate people to want to watch them, whether it be at a live event or to turn the TV on, especially to turn the TV on and watch it, watch that program, considering all of the different entertainment options that are all available at that exact same time. Because wrestling is not just competing with wrestling. TNA is not just competing with WWE, and WWE is not just competing with TNA. You're now competing with all the 120 or 240 or 360 other channels and all of their programming, too, that's going on at the same time.
Well, and the Internet as well, not only to mention the television, but the Internet stuff as well. And porn.
Yeah, you know, Internet does not play as prevalent a role as the other channels of TV for only one reason. I mean, at some point in time, it certainly is going to.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, for Mr. and Mrs. Walmart, who are accustomed to receiving their entertainment through the TV, it's kind of like where we're at right now.
Cable too?
Yeah, you know, we're at the point now with Internet and TV as we're getting at the point where TV was with radio, where people, you know, making that transition, and there, you know, people hung on to listening to radio programs instead of buying a TV or watching TV. because that was what they were accustomed to. That was what they were programmed to. That's what they were comfortable with. And the same goes still to this day for, you know, for TV, you know, and for broadcast TV to cable TV and et cetera. You know, it takes a while for that evolution, that jump. And for the vast majority, or the, like I said, the Mr. and Mrs. Walmart, which are the largest portion of your audience.
And they're probably large, too.
Expand it. Yeah. Well, certainly, yes. If anybody doubts it, go to I think it's called peopleofwalmart.com or something.
Mm-hmm. I could lose a lot of time on that. Just YouTube and peoplewalmart.com. But, Al, let me switch directions for you here. You know, you mentioned before the break, talk about any kind of three-letter thing. There's a new three-letter brand coming up from up north. It's called NXT, where I guess they're going to do some wrestling shows. They're also going to do some bit of Toughen Up. What are your feelings on that?
I don't know much about it, so I can't really venture an opinion. I just found out, I think it was yesterday, just some brief, stuff about it. So,
well, let me
it'll
ask
be interesting
you this,
to look at.
How did you feel when they kind of ended Tough Enough? I mean, I know that you were pretty invested in what was going on down there.
Well, I wasn't, you know, I thought it was a mistake, not because of my involvement in it, but I thought that ending Tough Enough was certainly a huge mistake for them, because I thought that Tough Enough was such a great, you know, infomercial for the wrestling business.
Absolutely.
And, you know, so many people from all walks of life came up to me on numerous occasions. Oh, well, you know, I was not a fan of the wrestling business, but I was a huge fan of Tough Enough and a huge fan of the kids on there, or I was a huge fan of Tough Enough and as a result became a huge fan of wrestling following the kids from there onto wrestling, you know, and even more people came up and said, oh, you know, I was a wrestling fan and now I have even greater appreciation and respect for what you guys do.
I thought that show did was it gave people a little more respect for what you guys go through, especially the first season. I thought the first season was amazing.
Well, Bob Holly beatdown also.
But the first season I thought was amazing because you literally had to watch guys take back bumps. I mean, it gave you just a kind of a foundation of what wrestling is.
Well, from a standpoint of just the basic mechanics.
Sure,
and
physicality.
And how much it really the athleticism and how much these guys really have to sacrifice as far as work effort and things like that to truly be a professional. Yeah, I mean, it was, you know, I thought that it did a very good job of doing that. And, the asinine idea that, oh, well, you know, they exposed the business. You can't expose something that's been exposed since the 1930s, for Christ's sake.
Right.
It's just, you know, that's absurd. You can't, you just can't do it. And because the only thing you're exposing to people is the idea that, you know, it's predetermined, because that's the only thing that's you know, fake. And looky, boys, it's been known for a long time. So, you know, it's just a ridiculous concept. And WWE made a lot of money for those three seasons that they had it on the air when they had that vain attempt at, you know, a compromise with putting it as a segment on SmackDown. It was the highest rated segment on SmackDown every single week.
Mm-hmm.
And, as a result of their turning down Spike TV, that was what led to the boom in UFC, was, doing a complete ripoff of Tough Enough with Ultimate Fighter. So, you know, I think it was a huge mistake then and a missed opportunity not to continue to take advantage of it. And it only makes sense that they would try to do something in some manner to resurrect it to continue to, you know, to take advantage of it now. So,
your chance to talk to Al Snow, 414-276-ESPN, 800-990-ESPN. Let's go to Austin on a cell. Austin, you're on the Pro Wrestling Report.
Hi, guys.
Hey, Austin.
I just had a theory about TNA's failure so far. I believe that they have the inability to make their characters larger than life, like how WWF has done for years. Like, you know, WWF today, like, comic book characters out of their wrestlers, and even WCW has done it back in the day with the Road Warriors, Vader, Sting and Ric Flair. And it just seems that TNA is just pretty much packaging their wrestlers like as average guys and such, and it just doesn't carry the imagination. Like it is just average people compared to being like a superstar like Edge or a giant like Cena or Undertaker and such. So what are your thoughts on that?
All right, thank you for the phone call.
Well, I think that Austin's on to something, and that is. Other than the crystal meth that he's taking while he's on the phone. But I think Austin's, on to something as far as WWE, Vince McMahon is very adept at making stars. And in my opinion, and my opinion is worth what it costs to get, TNA has made a tremendous error in that fact that they've not made stars. They have utilized other people, other stars that have been made in other places and downplayed the talent that they've grown there themselves. And in so much as when you take a guy who was a mid-level guy in WWE and you bring him into TNA and he beats all of your top guys and now becomes a top guy in TNA, subconsciously, even if it's subconsciously, you are now programming your audience to understand that your top guys are less than Vince's middle guys. And if you ever watch historically Vince's promotion, he never brings in other guys from other promotions and brings them and puts them right over the top of any other guy that he has there.
Not instantly. I mean, if you think of guys like Chris Jericho, I mean, how many years did it take a Jericho? Did it take a Benoit?
That's why.
Guerrero, yeah.
Because he makes them stars and doesn't allow anybody else, if you bring somebody from another group, in to downplay the very stars that he's made to make them seem less than anybody else. And he's done that very well. And that is a big mistake of TNA's. And to contradict, Austin one more time, I know that he's heavily involved in the heroin trade there in Milwaukee, but WCW failed miserably at making stars, too.
Yep.
And what I mean by a star is, everybody says, well, Sting's a star. Well, no, not if you go and you go walk down the street and you ask anybody to mention somebody on WWE TV, and nine times out of ten, they're probably going to remember them. Even guys, Bushwhacker, Greg Valentine, Jimmy Hart, you can name the names.
Yep.
Sting, even though he was on TBS, a nationally broadcast company, never, and I'm not saying this to put him down.
Right.
He's a very talented individual or whatever. But if he was not working for Vince, to be honest with you, he's not a mainstream star where just the average person, Mr. and Mrs. Walmart, will know it.
Yeah, and that's something that's been talked about for years. At WCW, the only real guy they ever made was Goldberg. I mean, that was the guy that people knew about.
Yeah. He was the one guy that really stepped out, of that shadow. And that was a complete happenstance, of its own accord. So, but the rest, it's not the case, and that is going to be the back to what I was saying about before the phone call, and it pretty much says the same thing, and that is that, TNA, in order to make a run at winning this war, or at least being competitive, is going to have to be able to have the talent pool and then have the understanding of how to make them their stars in their own right. The other thing that they're going to have to stop doing is trying to out-Vince Vince at being Vince.
Right.
Because nobody does Vince better than Vince. So,
when he's being Vince.
seriously, you can't be WWE. You have to be your own thing, and it has to be unique, and it has to be enough.
It's funny, Al, that you bring that up, because we kind of said, when we were having the Elijah Pope,
exactly.
kind of conversation, I said, why be the next somebody when you can be the first you?
Yep.
Well, and absolutely right. I mean, and you're not going to beat him at that. He's done it too long. He knows how to be him better than anybody else does, and you're not going to win. It just ain't going to happen. So you're going to, you're basically – You're playing pool with rope. It ain't gonna happen.
I'd pay for that show though.
Well, yeah.
you know, Al, you know, we talk about the different stars, but there's really two kinds of stars. There's baby faces, and there's heels.
Al, I
right?
was pointing at Dave because Dave wanted to go next, and if I would have knew that's where he was going, I would have just kept interrupting Dave
now,
over and over.
Meathead, one of his big deals is he says Randy Orton is not a true heel.
How's that?
I don't know. Yeah. So I think if anyone can give the correct answer, it would be you regarding a baby face and a heel.
Now let me preface this. Let me preface this by saying, and you're gonna obviously you're gonna go ahead.
We'll let Meathead give you his idea as to why Randy Orton's not a true heel.
Okay. Watching Randy Orton over the last handful of months, when Randy Orton comes out, and I've had guys like Rashi and Dave and Damian Nelson and Frank Costantino and even Dragon, the 180-pound guy behind the glass here, try to explain it to me. That's what I meant. Randy Orton, when he comes out, if you watch the Raw tonight, if you watch that opening match with Sheamus, 90% of that crowd is cheering Randy Orton from the second he breaks the curtain to the second he goes through the curtain again. Now, if he's supposed to be a heel, why is the entire crowd cheering for him? To me, that's not a true heel.
Okay. Well, I'll try to explain it to you.
Okay. Explain it to all of us.
No,
you're
the only
baseball player.
You're the only one.
Okay, well, if you're if you watch baseball or football or
all of it,
basketball. Okay, sometimes there are heels in those sports too. Correct.
Correct. There's a heel in this program. Apparently, I'm the guy because nobody likes me.
Well, that has more to do with your personality
exactly.
and the fact that I don't watch. Apparently, I'll just take your jokes for you.
Yeah. Circumstances dictate whether or not you're a babyface or a heel.
Correct.
The crowd reaction does not dictate whether you're a babyface or a heel. Okay? It is when you walk through the curtain, the crowd can and will, and a lot of times, cheer you or react to you and make noise for you because you're a star to them. Now, it is up to the circumstances that dictate whether or not you're now a heel or not. If that goes to what a heel's job is, okay? A heel's job is to make or get over a babyface. A babyface's job is to get over so that then
correct.
The heel can get heat, okay?
Correct. Yep.
Heat is not always anger or hatred. Heat is a need, a want. A desire that is created by the heel, and I haven't watched it, so I couldn't tell you.
I'll just give you an example of what happened tonight. It was Sheamus, the WWE champion.
Let Al finish.
Yeah, you're pump the brakes there, pal. Hold on. I'm trying to explain to you. What he did with Sheamus and all that tonight, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I didn't see it, and I don't know how they're
Al,
hold on.
Crotch shot real quick.
That's Rashi, by the way.
The thing is,
it's the couch, Al.
It's Sheamus,
the couch.
It's the couch. It's Sheamus versus Orton, and they're both heels. And this goof here is trying to manipulate you into thinking that he's against the babyface tonight. He's feuding with Sheamus. Has to make a decision.
Well, they're going to go with Orton because they see Orton as a bigger star.
Correct. And I agree with
that,
too.
Not as a babyface. Not as a babyface. They see him as a bigger star. And that, again, is circumstance that now – and babyface's jobs are to get over. Do you know what the term get over means?
Yeah.
Everybody uses
it. He's never done it, but he's heard of it.
I've never gotten over, correct, but I have heard of it from you guys.
What's the term get over mean?
To me, get over means to get a reaction from the crowd.
No.
Have them...
No, it does not.
Okay.
And that is what everybody thinks, and that's one of the biggest mistakes in the business.
Well,
get over
because I'm not in the business.
That's a pop.
You're still talking. Listen.
That was Rashi, by the way.
God gave you two ears and a mouth, one mouth for a reason. Twice as important to listen is to talk, okay, Toolbox? Now listen. You guys asked the question. I'm trying to answer it, and you're busy yammering. Now listen. To get over is to make the audience want to be you, to live vicariously through you, to idolize you. Think back to anybody that you really liked, Hulk Hogan, Steve Austin, all the you go on down the list, Sting, whoever you want, Ric Flair. At some point in time, you kind of imagined yourself being just like that guy. That's why Steve Austin sold all those T-shirts. That's why guys were running around tearing off their shirts and posing like Hulk Hogan. That's why people were painting the face and running around looking like a complete juiced-up ape monkey running screaming and breathing heavy. Because that's your job, is to make them want to believe they're just like you or that they want to be like you. That's the term get over, okay? Heels, the way they get heat is they don't, they're the guy you don't want to be. Well, if you're watching and there's two heels against each other and one's a bigger star and one is one, a guy that you know more than you do the other one, who are you going to want to be? You don't want to be Randy Orton, which now he's getting over, which in turn, in a heel versus heel situation, kind of makes him the babyface. Circumstance dictates that he's now the babyface because circumstance is that he's the bigger star. Otherwise, if he were to face John Cena or somebody else, circumstance might dictate, due to his actions and what is entailed and required that night in the ring, he'd be the heel. He'd be the guy that nobody wants to be, and he'd be getting his heat. Does that make sense to you? That's the thing that bothers me, because Randy Orton,
everybody does want to be Randy Orton. Doesn't matter who he's going out there against,
and
people want to be Randy Orton.
Lead, and that eventually might lead to the booker, or now the
mm-hmm.
group of writers,
sure.
Well, Vince will dictate to the writers, to start creating circumstances that direct him into being the babyface.
Which is what he's doing now.
What they may actually be doing is they might be giving the audience what they want
mm-hmm.
or making them, leading them to believe, because the way you get real heat is that you let the audience believe that they're going to get what they
mm.
want, which is that, ooh, we'll get to like Randy, and then they'll create a situation to where you take it all away from them and they hate Randy more, which puts heat even more stronger.
That would be tasty. That would definitely be tasty.
Yeah, but do you understand? And you have to stop thinking noise. Okay.
No, it's not
wrestling
noise. That
like,
I was...
No. You're saying he gets a reaction. You can't think reaction. The term get over is not that they react. Okay. But that's the problem with wrestling, is that too many guys in the wrestling business and fans themselves who think that they know the wrestling business all equate everything to simply the fans making noise. That ain't it. The same with the term pop. Pop is not fans making noise. The term pop is to get them to pop, to have an orgasm.
Meats never had
that
done that before.
David Hero. Frank has something to say. We have to pay bills.
Yes. Al, hang on. We're going to take
okay.
a break. When we come back, we'll finish up with Al Snow. And we still got time for your phone calls. You're listening to the Pro Wrestling Report on 540 ESPN and ESPNMilwaukee.com.
This is Phil Hellmuth, Wisconsin native and God's gift to poker. Have an ego, son? And you're listening to 540 ESPN Radio.
Final segment, Pro Wrestling Report, 540 ESPN and ESPNMilwaukee.com. Speaking with Al Snow, who's been with us this entire hour, educating not only the panel, but everyone listening. Al, we appreciate the time this hour. We've got about 5 minutes, and as we were talking, it's like, well, we only got 5 minutes left with Al. So
there's only one way to end the show.
There's only one way. Dave, take it away.
And I think that the world needs to hear a Marty Jannetty road story, especially the one, was it in India?
Yeah, the one where he drove the motorcycle through the lobby.
Yeah. Huge hotel, enormous lobby with a big fountain in the center of the lobby. And Marty, who has been kicked out of more countries than probably the U.S. Army, is walking out of the hotel and is walking down this huge, wide expanse of stairs that lead down to the street in India. And he, as he walks down, a motorcycle policeman pulls up and recognizes Marty, and starts talking. Oh, it's so good to meet you. You know, you're big wrestling stars. And Marty somehow charms the cop into allowing Marty to take a ride on his motorcycle. huge mistake. So Marty first takes the bike and runs down the street and then rides it back. And he's like, you know, the cop's like, oh, do you like, you know, you're handling pretty good. And, and Marty's like, yeah, yeah, it's great. Can I do it again? He goes, yeah. Zoom. Down the street he goes. Zoom. Back he goes. Zoom. Down he goes. And the cop's just having a great old time until Marty suddenly looks up and sees the stairs. You know, a bit of panic runs through you as you realize, oh, my God, he's getting an idea. He swerves towards the cop. The cop jumps out of the way. He jumps the curb and proceeds to ride right up the stairs up towards the hotel. The cop now is starting to go, what is going on? What is he going? I don't understand. Well, of course, nobody can understand. Only Marty can. And just as he gets to the top of the stairs, I mean, he couldn't have timed any better. The doormen are opening up the two big wide doors because they're, you know, trying to get a cart of suitcases out or something. I don't know what it was, but they're trying to move them out. Well, they open both the doors. Boom! Marty rolls right in through the two front doors and stops, hits the brakes, and kind of slides into the lobby. Kind of revs the bike a little bit, looks around. The promoter's standing over there with some other businessmen right beside the old fountain. And Marty decides, well, hey, what the heck? I've been here now. Decides he's going to take a few laps around the old lobby. not realizing that they had previously just waxed the floor. And he made it about a half a lap before losing it and slamming into the fountain, knocking both the promoter and the businessman and a couple of marks into the water fountain. Marty also flipping over the handlebars of the bike and taking a backdrop into the fountain himself, broke his toe from striking the fountain, but with no soul that got up, set the bike back upright, pulled the fender, which was now dented into the front tire, pulled the fender back out and figured, what the hell, and took three laps around the lobby with people screaming at him, and then rode back out and down the steps and to the policeman, who was completely freaked out, especially once he saw the bike was damaged. And, you know, I thought, well, he's going to jail now. And the cop was just like, oh, please don't tell anybody that I let you ride the bike. Don't let anybody know. This will be our secret. Hopped on the bike and rode off. So.
Wow.
Wow. Good old Marty.
Yes. Yes.
Well,
Marty,
you're
traveling with Marty was like traveling with Indiana Jones in the Temple of Doom.
We are going to see you this Sunday here in Milwaukee.
Sunday.
Yep.
And
that's right.
Al and Cousin
by
Jack
the whole
together
team,
again.
You only need the edge. Yes, Cousin Jack. You. Can't wait. Hopefully he'll do his electronic football player at the IHOP again.
Absolutely. That's a whole other road story in itself right there.
Yeah. Well, any story of Cousin Jack is a story in and of itself. So.
And he is over, you know.
Oh, he is
well, Al, thanks for your time this evening again for the entire hour.
I hope that I cleared it up for Meathead. I, you know, helped.
Al, you're hoping against hope right now. Let me let you know that. And by the way, keep the funnies going on to Facebook. I steal them and pretend like they're my own.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I got everybody upset last night. I kind of stirred the poo-poo up a little bit.
So. Yeah, just a little bit right there.
Yeah, the coat hanger thing might have been
some people didn't really get the joke. I mean, you know, it was kind of a double play. So,
yeah.
So.
Oh, well.
The whole handing out wire coat hangers at the anti-abortion rally was kind of a...
There you go.
People didn't get it.
I appreciate them.
And, Al, you're also on Twitter as well, correct? Al Snow?
Yes, I am on Twitter, too. So, you know, you can come follow my inane and ultimately disinteresting and boring life there, too. I mean, you know, but, you know, for those of you that have even a far boringer life, you know, feel free to follow mine.
Sounds good. Al, thanks for your time. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Al.
Thank you, guys.
Bye, Al.
We'll do this again next week, Monday. Damien should be back, I believe.
Depends on what's
happening. And again, this Sunday at the Bradley Center at, what is that?
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock.
Bobby Flam's on ice.
Frank,
Al,
you should know. You're always
Al
at catering for the Admirals.
Christy Hemme, Billy Robinson, Hacksaw Jim Duggan. Plus, we'll all be at Romine's afterwards watching the Elimination Chamber.
Sounds good.
David Hero, Steve Brown.
Yeah.
And the man named Carl Meathead. Dragon, great job behind the glass. Do this again next money. Next money. Next
about
Monday.
It's all about the money.
You're listening to the Pro Wrestling Report. 540 ESPN and ESPNMilwaukee.com.